For over 50 years, Julie Andrews has delighted audiences. After a recent throat operation, however, she's struggling to regain her world-renowned singing voice. Omnibus looks back at a remarkable career. Born in 1935 in Walton-on-Thames, Julie was already a star as a child.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in introducing to you our youngest soprano from Starlight Roof, Julie Andrews. Well, Julie, is this the first time you've ever made a gramophone record?
Oh, yes. Is it your first record, too?
No. How old are you?
I am 12. How old are you?
My mother and father divorced when I was quite young. So, from a very early age, I actually remember just commuting between the two families. My mother remarried, my father remarried, both had children. But my mother's second husband was Ted Andrews, and he had a wonderful tenor voice, and my mother, who was a fine pianist, joined with him, and they became a vaudeville team.
Ted was a big, bluff Canadian, and Barbara was a beautiful singer, who was also a very fine musician, and it was she who really taught Julie the principles of show business, and they used to drag poor Julie around with them, and she didn't like doing it.
My stepfather decided to give me some singing lessons. I think it was in an effort to get close to me, to make friends. I don't know. He had no idea that I had any kind of a voice, but suddenly he just said, well, let's see, you know, I'll teach her to sing and we'll have some quality time together, so to speak. And to his surprise and all of our surprise, I had this freak adult voice in a very little girl.
Julie joined the act, and initially, as far as I remember, although I didn't see this, I believe would stand on a box or soapbox or something to get up to Ted's height, and they would sing duets together.
The fiddles are playing a tune that you know. Hey-ho, come to the fair, the drums are all beating.
And then gradually, as in some sort of terrible B-movie, it changed from Ted and Barbara Andrews with Julie to Julie Andrews with Ted and Barbara.
So it comes then, maidens and men to the fair in the pride of the morning.
I first met Julie in 1947. We were in a show called Starlight Roof, which starred Vic Oliver and other luminaries. She was a child of 11, very solemn, very large eyes, enchanting, and we were both terrified. And we both used to shake before going on stage. And as soon as we were on, the shaking stopped and boom, we were into it. You know.
I first saw Julie many years before we met. She'd made quite a big splurge. There was quite a lot of publicity about this child with a phenomenal voice. And my mother said, this you have to see.
I followed an act done by a wonderful man called Wally Bogue.
And Wally used to do balloon sculpture, you know, blow up the balloons and then tie them all together and make animals. And an absolute tremendous hit.
At the end of his act, when he had all these wonderful animals, giraffes and dogs and poodles and things like that around, he asked if there was any little girl or boy in the audience who would like to come up and get one of these.
And I always remember this tiny, bony little thing suddenly said, I'm coming, I'm coming, and she ran up on stage.
And then the man who really was the star of the show was also on stage and would talk to me and say, what do you do? Well, I sing, you know, would you like to sing for us tonight? Sure.
What are you going to sing for us?
I'd like to sing the Polonaise from Nîmes.
Oh, lovely, just the kind of junk I like.
And she used to stop the show every night. She stopped it the first night, and from then on she took all the notices.
I think the amazing thing about Julie's voice was the clarity, the purity, and the range of it.
Thank you.
I first actually laid eyes on Julie in the flesh as opposed to in photographs. I think she was about 11 and I was 12.
Tony saw me in a production of Humpty Dumpty, I think, when I played the egg.
And when the egg fell from the wall, there was this enchanting little gal with some kind of chocolate makeup all over her egg, over her legs, which I found extremely seductive.
And he happened to be on the train going home to our hometown.
And then when we all got out at the station at Walton-on-Thames, I asked where she lived, and she said the other side of the tracks.
And the next thing I knew, Tony and his brother were around at the house, and they found out where I lived, and Tony began to write from college, and he wrote such sweet and lovely letters with wonderful drawings in them, and as you well know, he's now one of the leading designers on Broadway and in film, and he did little drawings of a book that he was doing. Eventually, we became boyfriend and girlfriend and went through our teens together.
She was quite often out on tour in what is here called vaudeville, but in England it was the music hall shows, and she would be in variety shows called things like Bells on Their Toes, B-E-L-L-E-S.
In music hall, you only did it for 1 week here or 1 week there, so you spent your life on a train.
So I toured and toured England many times and belted out my bastardized versions of operatic arias, and my mother accompanied the piano, but eventually I went out on my own, and they were good learning years, but they were tough and difficult.
They were a very mixed bag, these shows. Sometimes they were sort of accidentally wonderful, and sometimes they were almost heartbreaking.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say thank you so very much for the kind way you've listened to poor little me.
Though when it's only in retrospect that one realizes one was ever unhappy or uncomfortable or whatever. But actually, the ability to be a breadwinner and things like that, that came pretty naturally. I mean, we needed money, and I was able to manage it, and it kept us going.
Ted and Barbara were so used to being a big, popular act and with substantial earnings that when it reversed and Julie became the breadwinner, that was a tough passage for them. I remember she used to keep a journal, and this was a time when things were particularly rough at home, and her stepdad was going through some drinking problems and would have a tendency to break up the house now and then. And in her journals, she would refer to this as the most perfect and magical home, and how lucky she was.
I was doing Cinderella in London, and a lady who was the director of a play called The Boyfriend came to see the show and asked if I would like to come to Broadway.
The Boyfriend opened over here at a tiny, tiny theatre club, and it just took the fancy of people, the 1920s, the flapper period.
And they cast a new company to come to America. I said, oh no, I couldn't possibly leave home, and my family needs me, and I kind of had become a little bit the family caretaker.
And she'd knock on the door, open the door, and there's Julie. And for a moment I didn't recognize her with the light behind her, this beautiful girl. And she said, hello, Uncle Michael. She'd been crying.
She didn't want to do The Boyfriend because she realized she was going to have to be away from home for a serious chunk of time.
I'm off to America with Boyfriend. And I said, who is he? Thinking the swine taking this young child to America. She said, no, with The Boyfriend, it's the show. I said, oh, my God, yes. Well, why are you crying? It'll be a great success. Well, I'm frightened, and I don't want to leave home.
My dear real father said, Julie, for God's sake, go. It could last 3 months, it could last 3 weeks. It will open up your head. Do it.
We've got to have her, we've got to have her, for it's so dreary not to have her. Dream about
Dillisley was the first roommate I ever had, and it was the oddest but ultimately most satisfying coupling, because where I was absolutely painfully shy and wouldn't have dared venture out, she was this wonderful extrovert that wasn't frightened of anything.
She was a very private person, Julie, whereas I effervesced off in all directions, heaven knows what I used to say, and I don't think I went to bed for 4 months. Julie always did. She was very much more family-minded than me, I think. Her heart was always in England.
All we want is a room in Bloomsbury. Just a room that will...
Julie was very used to standing up there, playing this perky little girl, playing herself. Suddenly, she's being asked to play a girl who is lost, who is lonely, who thinks nobody loves her for anything but her money, who falls in love. It's a long journey she was asked to make at the age of 18.
Cy Feuer, our producer, came to me the day that we opened, and he said, you know, you were awful last night, you were terrible. And I said, I know, what happened? And he said, everybody else is being funny, everybody else is being comedic. I want you to just be absolutely straight. Just stay inside your character and be that lady who loses her love and whose heart is breaking.
I could be happy with you if you could be happy with me.
Everything I did from the heart. And it did work, and to my total surprise, it sort of threw me up into some kind of stardom, because the notices were wonderful the next morning, and I thank Cy from the bottom of my heart.
When we took the curtain call, Julie'd suddenly gone, and the audience were calling for her. She was the great success of the evening. Polly Brown, Polly Brown, Polly Brown, they kept saying. And I had to race to the dressing room, and... I grabbed her and said, come on, they're calling for you. Come back on stage.
I sang for Rodgers and Hammerstein for a show called Pipe Dream. I was just finishing The Boyfriend, about to go home after my year. And I sang for them, and when my aria was finished, Rodgers said, have you been auditioning or, you know, seeing anybody else? And I said, oh, yes, I've been auditioning for some gentlemen called Lerner and Lowe, and they're thinking of doing this musical version of Shaw's Pygmalion called My Fair Lady. And Rodgers paused for a moment, and then he said, I want to say something to you. If they ask you, I think you should do My Fair Lady. If they don't ask you, I'd like you to let me know, because we would like to also use you. But do My Fair Lady if they ask you.
All I want is a room somewhere, far away from the cold night, with one enormous chair. Wouldn't it be lovely?
I felt sure that I understood Eliza, but I didn't. I was too shy and too gauche and too full of insecurities in those years to know whether anybody would know that I could. And Marshart gave me such dignity and such great advice, and he really was very, very tough. You know, he closed the rehearsal process for about 48 hours, and we spent one very long weekend where he pushed and bullied and cajoled and showed me and was Eliza Doolittle sometimes, and then told me to stop acting like a girl guide and so on and so forth. He made me have a picture of what Eliza should be.
Who takes good care of me? How wouldn't it be lovely, lovely, lovely?
Wonderful, Julie. Absolutely perfect. Got the accent wonderfully.
Oh, thank you. What about the orchestra? Aren't they marvelous?
Are they?
Oh,
Rex had never done a musical before. He had never sung on stage before. But he was scared, and scared of an orchestra, and the orchestra drowning him out, and hearing things that he'd never heard before in the orchestra.
Had a woman in your life.
Stop, 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 stop! Take it out. I demand that be taken out.
Take out what?
That yatta-ta-ta-ta-ta! It's so loud. How do I know where to sing?
He was quirky, selfish, charming.
It's absolutely
dashing and brilliant. And I would learn so much just by standing on stage and watching him. However mad one got at him for the odd bit of selfishness, it was, he cut the mustard every single night so brilliantly that you forgave him everything.
Ye God!
From an average man am I.
An average man am I. Of no eccentric will. Who likes to live his life free of strife, doing whatever he thinks is best for him. Or just an ordinary man.
It's a huge piece because you have to scream like a cockney and you have to sing beautifully later on in the show.
I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night and still have begged for more. I could have spread my wings and done a thousand things I'd never done before.
When she came down those stairs, when she was ready to go to the ball, there was this beauty and this elegance. And you said, wait a minute, was this the one who did ow?
Excited crowd as the bride arrives. Julie Andrews, so well known to theatre audiences on both sides of the Atlantic.
Our wedding was kind of a zoo. I certainly wasn't expecting it. Rex Harrison's son, Noel, my best man, was using his top hat to smash people aside to try and get us through into the church.
After the ceremony, Julie and Tony face the difficult task of getting to the reception on time. So great is the throng. Soon they'd be waltzing away into their future. Here's happiness and good fortune to Tony and his fair lady.
I'm very nervous.
Have you ever acted with Richard Burton before?
No, never. I've never met him, as a matter of fact.
Is he going to do any singing in this Camelot?
I gather he is, and he's a Welshman. I should think he ought to be able to sing.
How do you think the story of King Arthur and his knights will adapt for a musical?
Well, I think it sounds fabulous.
Camelot was a wonderful experience because it was such a high-profile situation. It was the first Lerner and Lowe since My Fair Lady, and it's after the fact, it's very hard to explain that. But that sort of success that was enjoyed by, and deservedly by, Lerner and Lowe and Moss Hart, it was so opulent.
When Camelot started out, Moss Hart said, it doesn't have to be like it was in My Fair Lady. It doesn't have to be as backbreaking and miserable. We're all successful now. It can be a glorious experience. And so I brought this champagne and we're all gonna have a wonderful time. From that moment, everything went wrong. Adrian died, Fritz Lowe got a heart attack, and Alan had bleeding ulcers, I think. And Moss had a heart attack in Toronto. And on, until it was a riderless horse. There was nobody in charge of it. And it was Richard and Julie who kind of held it together.
I hear it never rains till after sundown. By 8 the morning fog must disappear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happy ever aftering.
Alan J. Lerner's writing style was that it took him a long, long time to perfect his lyrics. And sometimes two lines would take any number of days. But apparently he worked in a tiny closet underneath his stairs because he needed to box himself in so that there was no other distraction at all.
I walked into the theater one day and Alan, there was Julie up on the stage doing an entirely new thing. I think it was the Merry Month of May, I forget. But it was a whole number and new costume, and we were opening in 2 days. And I said to Alan, I said, but it's impossible. It's impossible to do it. And what if she can't do it? He said, oh, she will.
And of course she did, and it looked like she'd been rehearsing it for months. Just astonishing, astonishing professional.
Burton was probably the most charismatic man I've ever met. He was quite a flirt, and I have to confess that if he had wooed me at first, I probably would have succumbed just like anybody else would have.
Why do the simple folk do to help them escape when they're blue?
They sit around and wonder what royal folk would do, and that's what simple folk do.
Oh, no, really?
I have it on the best authority.
Yes, that's what simple folk do.
Later, he called me on the phone and he said, Time magazine says that you're the only leading lady I never slept with. And I said, well, don't tell them that, for God's sake. It'll make me more square than ever.
You're so high there. You're so putter there, partner. And I'm so how'd you do?
Julie and I met when she came to see me in Once Upon a Mattress. And her manager said, I think you two can hit it off.
And I thought, well, I don't know if I want to meet anybody new between a matinee and an evening show, but he persuaded us, and we met and had supper.
Her manager never got a word in edgewise, and all we did was pa-pa-pa-pa. The chemistry, the synergy was there. People recognized that. And CBS gave us a special at Carnegie Hall. Did it as a live show. We were scared. All these people were coming into Carnegie Hall to see us. We did a whole takeoff on the Pratt family. We called it the Pratt family. And there were 47 sons, and Julie was the mama.
I'm Mama.
I'm Papa. I'm Pedro. I'm Fran.
I had no idea that I would be asked to do the film. At the time, the show of Sound of Music was running on Broadway with Mary Martin in it.
I'm Cynthia.
We are the happy Swiss family Pratt. Back home in Switzerland.
I confessed to my chum, Carol Burnett, that I thought I was pregnant, and she said, ooh, how exciting. Carol tells a story of at the end of one song, she whacks me in the stomach with her hand, and it's part of the joke. But after it was over, she thought, oh my God, you know, Julie's pregnant, I hope it's okay. We had a beautiful daughter called Emma, and she's our pride and joy. She was such a good kid, one of those children that sort of miraculously raised herself, and she was such a trooper with it all.
It's Julie Andrews, incomparable Broadway star of My Fair Lady in Camelot, now starring in her first motion picture as Mary Poppins.
I went to New York and I caught the performance of Camelot. Of course, I'd heard the records and things, but it was Camelot that I saw her in. And then I went backstage and I tried to talk her into the thing, and I tried to convince her I was capable of making a picture with live actors as well as cartoons.
I think Julie felt she wasn't made for the movies, and so she was kind of hesitant. So Walt was putting every lure in her path.
It was quite amazing because he literally, on having just viewed Camelot just made up his mind that that's what he wanted.
I just designed, a funny thing happened on the way to the Forum, which was also fortunately a big success on Broadway at the time. And so he said, and you know, and you can come and you can work on the designs.
We discovered that he had several rooms filled with drawings of the way the film was going to be. It was completely laid out, all the penguin sequences and all the animated sequences and the live action sequences as well.
I couldn't wait to see it on film because it started out with me as the chalk artist drawing on the sidewalk. And I started describing the wonderful scenes, then we all jump into it. And I couldn't imagine how they were going to do that. And then we were in this magical land, and we do, it's a jolly holiday. I start out with, ain't it a wonderful day, bright as a morning in May.
I feel like I could fly.
Now, Bert, none of your larking about.
You would never have known that she had never done a movie before. She seemed to know exactly where the camera was and exactly what she was doing, even though she had always been a theatrical performer.
You'd never think of pressing your advantage. Forbearance is the hallmark of your creed.
True.
A lady needn't fear when you are near. Your sweet gentility is crystal clear. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with you, Bert. A jolly, jolly holiday with you.
If you think about it, the songs in Poppins have a kind of vaudeville quality, and I instantly connected with them and thought, my gosh, that I can do that. I can really contribute to that.
He traveled all around the world, and everywhere he went, he'd use his word, and all would say, there goes a clever gent.
When Dukes and Martha Rogers pass a time of day with me, I say me special word, and then we off to tea.
This is the night that Hollywood holds the world's spotlight. The annual Academy Awards and the bestowing of the coveted Oscars has a glittering audience on hand to hear Audrey Hepburn announce the best actor.
Rex Harrison.
Rex Harrison, of course, receives his statuette for his role of Professor Higgins in My Fair Lady, chosen as the best picture of the year. Audrey was his leading lady.
I think one thing that really upset a lot of us who'd known Julie since she was a child, and that was Julie not getting My Fair Lady, the film.
While we were visiting her principal agent, there was an explosion, and several other younger agents burst into the room yelling, "We did it! We did it! We got the part for Audrey!" And it was their moment of discovering that indeed Audrey Hepburn was going to be playing the role. They had no idea that this was Julie sitting in the room. It was a truly macabre moment.
I did really understand an awful lot of why I didn't get it. And Poppins came along so fast after that that it was more than wonderful compensation for losing it. It's only in later years that I thought, oh, I wish I'd put that role down definitively.
Julie Andrews.
Julie Andrews played opposite Rex Harrison in the stage version of My Fair Lady. Passed over for the movie role, she played Mary Poppins and parlayed the part of that bouncy governess into tonight's triumph.
Oh, this is lovely. I know you Americans are famous for your hospitality, but this is really ridiculous.
Star Julie Andrews and producer-director Robert Wise. They are on location in the Austrian Alps to film the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical, The Sound of Music.
She had done Mary Poppins. It was still in the cutting rooms, and nobody had seen it. But there was a little buzz around town that maybe she wasn't as photogenic as she might be. So we got permission to go over to the Disney Studios one day and saw a couple of reels of the rough cut on Mary Poppins. The minute she came on the screen, we sort of, well, there's no problem, no question about that there. That's our girl.
Doe, a deer, a female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, a name I call myself.
We had seen Sound of Music on stage together and thought the role was perhaps not an ideal one for Julie. There wasn't a lot of spice in it. It was rather sentimental, and she had already just played a governess.
It was hard to know then what I recognize now, which is that it was the most extraordinary opportunity anybody could have.
Girls in white dresses with blue satin sashes, snowflakes that stay on my nose and eyelashes, silver white winters that melt into spring. These are a few of my favorite things.
There was a danger that we could become hideously sweet and sugary because we had religion and children and Austria and the Alps and music and things like that. And so we all tried in our own way to give it more of an astringent quality.
Fräulein, were you this much trouble at the Abbey?
Oh, much more, sir.
Mm.
I think Chris's contribution particularly rooted the film.
Excuse me, sir, I don't know your signal.
You may call me Captain.
I was so pleased as we got into the film that she just had such a range of emotions and talent that far, far beyond what I really had somehow expected. I don't know what I expected because she'd been such a star on the stage, but there wasn't any moment in the film in terms of her character that she didn't come up with in spades.
I was frightened.
Frightened? Were they unkind to you?
Oh, no.
Bob was very patient with me. He taught me a lot about filmmaking. Taught me how to be still on camera, also was a wonderfully calming influence.
We thought that the song that the Captain Maria sang in the little pagoda to the end where the professor left was really not a particularly strong song. It was called An Ordinary Couple. And we just felt we should get a better one than that, but we had to get Richard Rogers okay, and he agreed completely. He said, it is kind of an ordinary song. I think I can get you something better.
So somewhere in my youth or childhood, nothing ever could. Richard Rogers wrote the lyrics and the music for Something Good. Oscar had passed away by then. It is such a pretty song, and it's done in such a beautiful setting in the film. I must have done
to the Sound of Music premiere together. To be with her was overwhelming because everybody reacted to her like she was part of their family. They owned her. And so everywhere you went, it was one of those things that you read about and you can't believe is going to happen. That sort of fame requires that one has the guts to overcome it, because it can be deadening when you are suddenly lionized and departmentalized. Because everybody's saying, well, no, you must do this. No, you can't do this. That would hurt your public image. And she would come to the beach with Emma, and people would come up to the beach with Mary Poppins dolls, and it was like, life for her was like being on a personal appearance.
She was the lovable, good-hearted, extremely welcoming person that everybody wanted to take into their arms and hug because she was so wonderful, as opposed to the crassness we see around us in everyday life.
There was a kind of Hollywood perception that if you could get Julie, you could get the earth. So agents and lawyers and managers and producers were desperate to tap into this seemingly magic touch.
I'm not a scientist, I'm a teacher.
You're a scientist, and you're supposed to respect a natural order in all things. Breakfast comes before lunch. Ow! Mm. And marriage should come before a honeymoon cruise.
Jimmy, oh Jimmy, oh what joy.
Now James Michener's monumental novel, his beautiful, fierce vision of paradise comes to life.
I'm not going to let you go a second time.
don't! Rick, I'm expecting. I'm a child.
The scale of that kind of Hollywood success was compounded by the fact that the studio system was going through a tremendous change. And the films that she worked on were perceived at that time to have literally saved three studios.
I was so busy doing and absorbing and having considerable success just hit me that I think, A, it knocked me sideways a little bit, because you can imagine there was a great deal of an assault by press and publicity and things like that. But secondly, I didn't have much time to get perspective on it all, not until much, much later.
At a time when I think she probably needed a lot more support than I was able to give her. I was off trying to maintain my own professional life, and that's a... I don't know how you solve that when the success of the scale of what happened to Julie happened. It always puts people in that position, and those associated with them through some pretty horrendous situations, and we didn't survive that.
I can only say that we're friends to this day, and we know so much about each other because we go back so far that there's no need for pretense or stupidity. The fact that we didn't stay married is sad, but we've made our peace with it, and we've just stayed very, very good friends.
If the lady's naughty but proper, if the lady's chicer than chic, if her escorts must wear a topper, and each man's the man of the week.
I've never known Julie to be a quitter. It's not like her character. She may be disappointed at some point, but then she's ready to go right back to work again. Her ebullience comes through when whatever she does.
When I shook my pelvic girdle, well, he did a double hurdle.
Your appendix?
Just tremendous.
Cerebellum?
Simply swell him.
But he never said.
He loved my sinuses and spleen and every organ in between.
And yet he never said he loved.
A vague movement has no effect on stage. It must be precise. Her hands, as she places them, as she sings it, is exactly right. It looks like simple movements. People say, I can do that. You say, okay, let's see you try it. And it doesn't come across because the lyrics don't register. The song doesn't register. The point is not made unless it's done with great precision and a great sense of performance and humor.
Jenny made her mind up when she was 12 that into foreign languages she would delve. But at 17 to Vassa, it was quite a blow that in 27 languages she couldn't say no. Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find. To Jenny I'm beholden, her heart was big and golden, but she would make up her mind.
It was so disappointing. We opened in London, and Sound of Music had played the Dominion Theatre in London for 4 years. And I'll never forget the first review I read on Star when it came out. Said, well, I guess there goes the Dominion Theatre again to Julie Andrews for 4 years. You know, it was just a marvelous review. But somehow, it just didn't catch on with the audience.
I don't think they were ready to receive the image of Julie as the self-centered, bitchy Gertrude Lawrence. It was just too contrary to everybody's feelings about Julie. I think it offended them. They didn't want to see her in that light.
He's my lover, my friend. What more?